I'm going to show you the jazz chords and jazz patterns for Mel Torme's Christmas song that he wrote in 1946. Now, Mel was one very hip jazz cat. His whole image was built on jazz. He's one of America's most famous and beloved jazz voices. In addition to being a very talented singer and drummer, Mel also was a prolific songwriter, writing with his writing partner, Bob Wells. So this song was originally conceived with jazz chords and jazz changes. It can be played a lot of ways, but that's how it originally started. So it's only fitting that we should take a look at some jazzy ukulele jazz patterns to see how it's put together. We usually find this song in the key of E-flat in jazz fake books, but I'm going to put it in D because it lays out much better on the ukulele or the guitar in the key of D than it does in E-flat. And we're going to be using our jazz patterns as much as we can from the Jazzy Ukulele Workbook number 1 and number 2. Mostly we're using patterns from Workbook number 1, the second set of patterns that you'll find in the workbook there. For those of you that aren't familiar with the jazzy ukulele approach, you'll be hearing a lot about jazz patterns in this short lesson. Our object when we work with the workbooks is to try to reduce all the songs in jazz standards down to recognizable and familiar jazz patterns that we make with the same reoccurring hand shapes as we go from song to song. And this song is rich in jazz patterns, so once we understand where the patterns are, it makes learning all those chords a lot easier. It looks like a lot of chords on the page, but when you reduce them to these familiar hand shapes and patterns, you'll find out that we're using the same shapes and just putting them in different locations on the ukulele neck. The song only has two sections, an A section and a B section. That means two different sets of chords. It's typical jazz form that we call AABA. That means the A section gets played three times. Every time it gets played, same chords but different lyrics, and the B section gets played once. What we're going to do is take the A section and look at it in four different parts so we can try to understand it and learn it easily. Why four different parts? Because that A section ends differently every time we play it. The first three parts are always the same. So we're going to look at those three parts first because those we repeat every time we play that A section. But we end it with a different set of chords every time. And so we're just going to go learn the first three parts and then go back and learn how it ends differently every time. Then we'll skip right to the bridge. So the first part uses what we call a 1-2-3-4 progression. And this refers to the first four notes of a major scale. We're in the key of D, and those first four notes are D, E, F sharp, G, A, B, C sharp, D. We're just going to take those first four notes and make chords off them to come up with our 1-2-3-4 progression. So the first one is a D major 7, and we're going to make it with this hand shape here. We're covering fret 2 here and here, and fret 1 back here. And then this high A string is left open. So we have a D major 7, and the 2 chord is an E minor 7, the 3 chord is an F sharp minor 7, and the 4 chord is a G major 7. So there's our first part, and put words to it, it's chestnuts roasting on an open fire. There's the first part. Let's take a look at the second part. Here we've got a D major 7 to start with, back to the first chord we began with. We're going to play this, and then follow it with a 3-chord major pattern that's not in either one of the workbooks. It looks like this, pretty easy to make. It's A minor 7 to D 13, which looks like this. We're covering everything on fret 2 except for the C string that's open. Going to a G major 7, so that's our 3-chord major pattern, and we follow it with a C 13, that's quite easy to make, beautiful chord. We've got a finger on fret 3, and we've got the middle finger on fret 2, and these two strings are open. So that second part sounds like this. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. And the third part of the song starts with a B minor 7 here. Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. What we have there is a B minor 7 to begin with. Yuletide carols going to a G minor 6. Now this, you'll see I've got two frets covered here on fret number 2. I'm putting this finger down, fret number 1, putting this one. Got two open strings. Now if I covered this with my index finger covered both, I'd have a G minor 7 chord. This might look familiar. All I'm doing is releasing this string and bringing the finger down here, turning the G minor 7 into a G minor 6. So Yuletide carols, and I go back to a D major 7, the one we opened up with, being sung by a choir, and here the major pattern starts. And that gives us the first three parts of the opening section of the song that will repeat every time we play this section. And each time we'll finish with something different, but up to this point, we're always going to play these same chords. So let's take those first three parts again, because that's what we'll be using each time we play this section, starting with the D major 7 chord and the 1, 2, 3, 4 progression. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Back to the D major 7. Jack Frost, now the major pattern, nipping at your nose. Now going to the C dominant 13 chord. Now we go to the B minor 7, to G minor 6, to D major 7, and the two chords of the major pattern. And now what happens? Let's finish off this section by completing the major pattern sung by a choir and folks. So that would be the major pattern sung by a choir and folks. Now we go to fret number 3. Dressed up like Eskimos. And then end with the two chord major pattern. Everybody knows. Let's look at the second ending that we use when we get to that point in the first section. It's the same hand positions. We go up here just like we did before. When we go, tiny tots with their eyes all aglow. And now we use two major patterns. We use the same hand shape, but we come down here, cover fret 2, and make it here. We'll find it hard. And then we take the major pattern to the open position. To sleep tonight, ending it with that same D major 7 chord. So tiny tots with their eyes all aglow, well down to fret 2 major pattern, then open major pattern tonight. Now let's see how it ends the third time we come through that section. So it's the very end of the song this time, when it says, though it's been said many times, many ways. And here's the third ending. Merry Christmas, to a D major 7, to a Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas to you. And so what happens there is, on the Merry Christmas, we got the D major 7, just like we opened up the song with, and we go to an E minor 7, but I'm leaving off the ring finger, which turns it into an E minor 7 sus chord. And just repeating that a couple of times, Merry Christmas, now to the sus, Merry Christmas, then to the sus, Merry Christmas, now to a three chord major pattern, to you. Song ends with a three chord major pattern, as most jazz standards do. I talk about that in the workbook. Our bridge is easy to understand because it's made up of three major patterns. We have two different three chord major patterns followed by a two chord major pattern. Let's look at these major pattern shapes that are found in workbook number 2. So we're making A minor 7 all open, and the D13 we're making here with covering these three frets on fret number two, and this one's open on fret one. They know that Saint is on his way. Repeat. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies in his sleigh. And now we go back here to the shape that we use in workbook number two, but here it's very easy because it's open chord. We have a G minor 7. Mother's child to the companion, it's 13, is gonna spy to the F6-9. And then we go back to our two chord major pattern we have, like we used in the first part of the song, to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And here we can also leave off this ring finger to get the suspended minor, to see if reindeer really know how to fly. It's companion 13. Here is the bridge one more time down again. I'll play the A minor 7 with everything open. So it's three chord major pattern. They know that Saint to the 13th is on his way to the G major 7. Repeat that. He's loaded A minor 7 and D 13 and G major 7. Now I go to the open G minor 7. G minor 7, C 13, and F 6-9. Now I go to the two chord major pattern to see if reindeer, which is the E minor 7, and I'm going to take off the ring finger, make it that suspended. Reindeer really know how to fly. It's companion, the A 13. So those are the chords and jazz patterns that jazz players use when they play Mel Torme's Christmas song. Now let me give you one more enhancement that you can use for the first section of the song that you might enjoy. When we get to the various endings on the first section of the song, we go up here, starting on fret 4, and we're using this major pattern that starts like this. And so it's this part of the song when we go, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. So when you get to choir, and every time you get to this major pattern here, we can take off the little finger, just like we did in other places where we use the major pattern, and it turns it into a minor suspended chord, and it actually matches the melody on the song at this point, and it's just got a wonderful jazz sound. So it's, instead of putting the little finger, it's actually easier to play and then going to its companion. So it's Yuletide carols being sung by a choir and folks. Now we go to the same thing here. We'll leave it off. Dressed up like Eskimos. And then one more time here. Everybody. So that's just an alternative way to play the major patterns at that point in the song. And actually, they're easier to play, so it's up to you however you want to do it.